Good morning. I hope you had a nice weekend and enjoyed this wonderful summertime in San Luis. And I also hope that this means that we are ready to take on the next challenge and continue our conversations about the diagrammatic methods for Mandelbrot systems. So as you remember, we dedicated the entire last lecture to a couple of examples where we examined the various aspects of a diagrammatic calculation, focusing on the determination of the final results that you otherwise could obtain with Weak's theorem. We could see that we can obtain correct results that Weak's theorem predicts by drawing the resulting non-equivalent diagrams and reading the signs, the weights, and the scalar factors from these diagrams. Of course, one of the important things, the most important things that we sort of uncovered last time was the statement that in order for this machinery, this diagrammatic machinery, to work correctly, we have to guarantee that our weights are defined in such a way that the weight of the resulting diagram equals the product of the weights of the initial diagrams times the number of times you can obtain a given resulting diagram. Okay, so this will be one of the important threads here. So I would like to continue today on these topics. We'll have a couple of more, couple of additional examples that illustrates some of these concepts further. The first example today, or I think the fourth example overall in our discussion, is the calculation involving the following expression. We have here a two-body operator Vn in the normal product form. So I'll write again the way our definition of it. It is in the normal product form, so in the normal product we have xp dagger xr xq dagger xs. Okay? And then C2 is an excitation operator that we discussed previously when I was talking about the full CI representation of the wave function. C2 is the doubly excited part, or is an operator that generates the doubly excited part of the wave function. So it is formally an operator that has some coefficients C, A, B, I, J, where A is, say, greater than B, I is greater than J, times the excitation operators E, I, J, A, B, where we define E, I, J, A, B as the product of E, I, A times E, J, B, that is our, the product of our elementary single excitation operators. And of course, we know from our definitions that this is the same as writing X, A dagger, X, I, X, B dagger, X, J. We can leave it as it is now, or we can simply add the normal product to this expression, because we know that all four operators in this expression are the Y dagger operators. Okay. So what we have here is an attempt to calculate the expectation value of the product of these two operators, V, N, and C2, in the Fermi vacuum. And of course, you may ask yourself, you may ask the question, where would this appear? Well, this appears, for example, in CI, in a CI configuration, in a configuration interaction calculations. Okay? If I write the Schrödinger equation, H psi equals E psi, okay, say for the ground electronic state, and suppose I, let me actually rewrite it in the form which is more convenient for many of our considerations, namely I replace H by Hn, and I'll replace E by delta E, where Hn is the Hamiltonian in the normal product form. And you remember that's the difference of the Hamiltonian and the expectation value of it in the Fermi vacuum state phi. And then delta E is simply the shifted energy, the energy minus the expectation value of the Hamiltonian. Okay? So if you write, so this is now a rewrite of the Schrödinger equation, but a little bit more consistent with our way of writing things here, where we represent all quantities relative to the Fermi vacuum. You see, then, you know, with this rewrite, delta E is not the total energy of a system, but it's actually the correlation energy of it, right? Because phi is a single determinant, and if phi is the Hartree-Fock determinant, then E minus the Hartree-Fock energy is, of course, the correlation energy. So this is nothing else than the Schrödinger equation written in this form adjusted to the correlation energy definition. And if I have the Schrödinger equation like this, and if I want to solve it using, say, Ci, what I do next is I say that I represent the wave function psi as a linear combination of determinants obtained through excitations from a Fermi vacuum. So I'll use the form that we used some time ago, where C0 is the coefficient at the reference determinant phi, C is an excitation operator, which we write as a sum of one body component C1, two body components C2. In the exact theory, you have to go all the way to Cn, where Cn is an operator exciting all n fermions in a system. Okay? Let's, for convenience, assume that C0 is chosen to be 1. We call this an intermediate normalization. Then our expression, our Schrödinger equation, assumes the following form. Hn acting on 1 plus C acting on the phi gives you delta E 1 plus C acting on the phi. Okay? So this is really the Ci problem. In practice, of course, we truncate C at some level. Okay, I'm not going to worry about it right now. Typically, you would say stop at, say, quadruples or some other level that is appropriate for your problem. But what I want to do with this equation is now to see, well, suppose I want to compute the energy from it, the correlation energy, that is delta E. I don't have to worry about this part because that's just an expectation value of the Hamiltonian, which is very easy to determine. We already talked about it. So what do I do? Well, let's project both sides of this equation on the reference determinant phi. And you can see what happens on the left-hand side. You end up with phi hn 1 plus c phi. And on the right-hand side, you obtain delta E times phi 1 plus c phi. Okay? Let's look at both sides of this equation. Well, on the left-hand side, you can see you have phi h and phi, but that's going to be a zero, because we already said that the expectation value of the operator in the normal product form is zero. So I can just ignore this part, okay? So in other words, maybe I'll just cross it like this, okay? We can ignore this part. So on the left-hand side, we end up with simply phi h n c phi. That's going to be what is left. And then on the right-hand side, you see you have phi 1 phi, which is 1, because phi is normalized to unity, and then you have phi c phi. But phi c phi is 0 too, because c excites fermions, okay? So you end up with excited determinants, which are all orthogonal to the phi, so you end up with a 0. So on the right-hand side, it's the c term that we can ignore, okay, in this calculation. That means that we proved now that delta E, the correlation energy, or the energy minus the expectation value of the Hamiltonian in the phi, is defined by this expression, okay? Well, clearly, I'm not going to now spend more time on it than what I just did, but clearly you remember that Hn has two parts, the Fock operator part and Vn, okay? We talked about it when we talked about the Hamiltonian in the normal product form, and C, of course, contains these various excitation. So C is C1 plus C2 plus C3 and so on. Obviously, you can see that among various terms, there is a product of Vn from Hn and C2 from the C. Okay? And in fact, we can show that actually pretty much there's nothing else. And only C1 will survive this if the Hamiltonian has only two-body interactions in it. Because if it has only two-body interactions, you know, if I have a two-body operator here, then if I put C3 here, it's going to be zero. Okay? Yes?
I'm sorry, I'm not following why we use the one and the first on the left-hand side.
Because you end up with phi, h, n, phi.
Oh, okay.
Okay, then, okay, all right. Phi, H n phi is zero.
Sorry, H n, yeah.
Yes, right? Yes, and of course, you know, you know, this is a consequence of the general statement that we made some time ago, that the means that the expectation value of the operator in, of any operator in the normal product form is zero. But you can also sort of retrieve it from this definition. If I take an expectation value of this, these two will simply cancel out. Okay? So you can see it once again. All right? In any case, this is the energy expression that drives a lot of calculations. And in our case, we can see that it does contain V and C2. So that term I'm going to consider in example 4 is actually quite relevant. Okay, in many body considerations. So let's deal with it. Of course, we want to deal with it diagrammatically. That's the whole idea here. All right? So in order to do so, to sort of prepare the way, we know how to represent the V. The question is, how do I represent C2 as it is defined there? Okay? You can see that C2 here is defined in a way which is still not quite ready for diagrammatics because we don't want to have these constraints when we define many-body operators in a diagrammatic context. At least we prefer not to use those constraints. We can, of course, you know, it's not like we can do things, various things, but you know, we prefer not to do this. So so let's deal with C2 a little bit, okay? Just to prepare ourselves for all the diagrammatic work. First of all, maybe I should also remind you what we already discussed, is that I said at some point, or I wrote at some point in the equation, that if I look at the n-body excitation operator in the C, okay, which is defined in a very similar way, it's going to be a summation over ordered sets of indices, say A1 through An, I1 through In, but ordered, so I'm putting inequalities here, and then we have some coefficients C, A1, An, I1 through In, and then the corresponding n body excitation operators, okay? We already talked about it. We said that these quantities are anti-symmetric with respect to permutations of indices, so you can actually replace this by 1 over n factorial squared, the sum over unconstrained indices I1 through In and A1 through, maybe I'll write it in the same way I have here. Let's start with A's this time. Okay. Maintain the same form. So we have A1 through An, I1 through In, and then we have these coefficients C, A1 through In, I1 through In, and the excitation operators. Okay? So we expect that the same has to happen here. This has to be 1 over 2 factorial squared, which is 1 over 4. A sum over all AB and all IJ, okay? C, AB, IJ, E, IJ, AB, okay? All right? I'll actually redo it for C2 right now so we remember this information very well because we really will need to use these expressions many times in the future, okay? So, you know, this is a general statement. Okay, you know, you can replace the ordered sets of indices by the unconstrained summations by sticking the 1 over n factorial term with a square, okay? And you know, we can see it if we just deal with C2 specifically. So how would I prove it, actually, for C2? You start with your definition, okay? What I'm going to do now is I'm going to write this expression four times, four copies, you know, in the following way. I'll write it as sum over A greater than B, I greater than J, C, A, B, I, J, E, I, J, A, B. Then I'll write another copy of it, which will look like this. A greater than B, I less than J, C, A, B, I, J, E, I, J, A, B. Then I'll write the third copy, which will look like this, C, A, B, I, J, E, I, J, A, B, A less than B, I greater than J, and then the fourth copy will be a sum over A less than B, I less than J, C, A, B, I, J, E, I, J, A, B. Okay? I claim that I wrote 4 copies of this expression. Why would I know? How do I know this? Well, we know this, and I'm not done yet, so let's continue. Right? We know this because if you look at the definition of C2, okay, which is still over there, you can see that if I act with C2 on the phi, and if I project it against a specific double excited determinant phi ij ab from the expansion that you see here, you will end up with CABIJ. Okay? So that means that there is the following relationship. This is actually a way, you know, if someone gives you a wave function psi that has C2 in it, well, that would be your way to extract the coefficient C. Of course, typically we proceed the other way around. We compute the C's by solving the Schrödinger equation. But that's the relationship. And the point of this relationship is to realize that that we know the anti-symmetric properties of the determinants. We know that if I flip, for example, J and I and leave AB intact, that will change the sign. Okay? If I flip A and B, okay, so I write BA here, that is also flipping the sign. If I permute I with a J, obtaining JI, and A with a B, obtaining BA, that will of course not change the sign. But those are the properties of determinants. Because these determinants are present here, that means that these C coefficients have the same relationship. So in other words, they are also anti-symmetric coefficients. So let's register this. That's a useful piece of information as well. Not only now, but also in the future. Okay? So, this means that if I now go back to my calculation where I made a claim that those are 4 copies of the same expression, you can see that they are. You know, how would you prove that this, for example, is the copy of this? Well, all you have to do, you can see, is to replace here I with a J. Okay? If I replace I with a J, then you will end up with I greater than J, which is exactly what you have here. Here you will end up with JI, and here you will end up with JI. Okay? So all you have to do is to flip them simultaneously. If you do it simultaneously, then the sign will not change. And I end up with the first expression. And in the same way, I can process all the remaining expressions. Here I have to flip. I have to replace A by B and B by A and do the flipping. And here I have to replace I by J and vice versa, and A by B and vice versa. Okay, so those are 4 copies. But because they are 4 copies, I can't just leave it as it is. I have to stick 1 over 4 in front of the expression. Now I've got the right formula. Okay, and this of course means that if I want to know what C2 is, then you can see I can write it as 1 over 4 sum over I different than J and A different than B. So we have a quadruple summation where we do not allow I to be identical to J and A to be identical to B. Okay? But I can take one step further from these anti-symmetric relationships. If I or J are equal, or if A or B are equal, these coefficients are zeros. So I can artificially throw these zeros in and end up with 1 over 4 sum over I, sum over A, B, I, J, C, A, B, I, J, E, I, J, A, B. Well, all of this, I guess a little lengthy consideration, is telling us that C2 is just like every other two-body operator. That is, we don't have to somehow treat these operators differently. They are two-body. That means that you can expect that C2 is de facto 1 over 4 sum over A, B, I, J, some matrix element A, B, C, 2, I, J, which is an anti-symmetric matrix element, and then E, I, J, A, B, okay? Which is itself a normal product of X A dagger, X I, X B dagger, X J. Okay? So in other words, I can certainly claim that there exists an operator little C2, which would show up in the first quantized definition of capital C2, that produces these coefficients, C A B I J. Of course, we rarely use excitation operators in the context of first quantized calculations, that is sort of not impossible. You know, you can have a sort of a coordinate interpretation of these types of operators, but you know, we typically use them, of course, in second quantization, because then these C's are amplitudes of the wave function that you obtain by solving the Schrödinger equation using, for example, CI. In any case, once you have this observation, you can now do more work. You can, for example, claim that this is also 1/2. You know, you can sort of write it in a non-symmetric form. I can write it as 1/2 sum over ABIJ and then ABC2IJ, okay? And once again, EIJAB. All right, so once I know that there exists an underlying little C2 operator behind all of this, then of course I can also have this form, which is perfectly consistent with what we're doing here in a diagrammatic representation. You can see that this is a normal two-body operator, just like every other two-body operator, with one difference. In a normal two-body operator, here you have PQ, here you have RS. Okay, and those PQ, P's and Q's and R's and S's are generic indices. Okay, well here we're making a constraint that PQR have to be unoccupied, RS have to be occupied. So this is why we call such two-body operators particle-hole excitation operators. Okay, this is specifically a two-particle, two-hole excitation operator. Okay, because of its this specific requirement that PQ are unoccupied and IJ are occupied. Other than that, it's a two-body operator, which means that we can certainly proceed with diagrams. If what I do this though, is I would like to make sure that I know what I'm supposed to obtain. Because, you know, that's how we are presenting these examples so far. You know, we sort of look at the examples where we know the result, and then we're trying to see, can we get this result diagrammatically? So, you know, how could I know, how would I predict what is the value of this expression? Well, you know, one simple way to do this is just to replace C2 by the definition. So it's going to be, you know, I'm going to use the bottom formula. 1/2, okay, and then you'll have a summation over ABIJ. Then you'll have, this matrix element ABC2IJ. And then you will have phi VN phi IJAB. Right? Simply. So I have a product of the amplitude here times the matrix element involving phi and the doubly excited determinant, because EIJAB acting on the phi produces doubly excited determinants. Okay? Well, you know, fortunately we already dealt with this expression. Okay? We know what it is. It is IJAB anti-symmetrized. Okay? Okay, we computed this before using Weak's theorem. That's one of the Slater rules, as a matter of fact. So, let me then continue. We expect that this expression should give us 1/2 a sum over ABIJ IJVAB anti-symmetrized, this sort of matrix element, times the coefficient ABC2IJ, defining our two-body excitation operator C2. Of course, you know, you can easily show, I'm not going to do it because this is really trivial now, you can move that anti-symmetrization symbol here. Okay? So I can also write it. Someone prefers to have a non-symmetric matrix element of the V here, but then to have the anti-symmetrized matrix element of C2 here, and that is of course the original amplitude that I called before CABIJ. Okay, so you can also write it this way, and if you prefer to use anti-symmetrized matrix elements all the time, everywhere, well then you can put an anti-symmetrizer here and 1 over 4. Okay. Well, that form will also show up in our considerations sooner or later. Okay, so we have all of this. I will just rely on the top form, okay, diagrammatics. I'll try to simply recover it. So how do we proceed on this? Well, we start the usual way. Start with diagrams representing our operators V and C2. Please note that this is now a new situation compared to all the previous examples, because we are now having free indices. We are summing over all these indices. Okay, in the original definitions of B, we have PQRS, we are summing PQRS's over. And in C2, although they have A, B, I, J, these A, B's, A and B and I and J are not fixed. They're also summed over within the corresponding ranges of unoccupied and occupied indices, okay? So we have to keep in mind that this is different. All the previous examples were fixing A, B, I, J in our calculation. We're not going to do this now, so we'll see how this works in a situation where all indices are free. So, what do we have this? Maybe I'll still use this blackboard a little bit. So we have V, or Vn, I should say, with indices P, Q, R, S, and we have C2, which is a two-body operator, okay? So you have to draw it in a way similar to V, except for some different symbols in it, but you have to remember, now we have, this is a particle hole excitation operator, which means that we have all the white dagger operators in it, which means that we have to stretch all the lines to the left. So this will be an operator which doesn't look like V exactly. It will have a vertex, which of course I have to draw differently. I'm going to use this sort of oval, okay? But it will have all four lines extending to the left because they are Y-dagger lines. So you have AI, so you have one simple vertex AI and another simple vertex with lines BJ added. That's the proper representation of C2, okay? I could not use this kind of form for C2, once again, because this is an excitation operator, which means that all the lines in it, external lines in it, must extend to the left. Okay, well, so what do we need to do with this expression? We need to now calculate, once again, the expectation value in the phi. I guess I'll do it one more time. Maybe I said I'm not going to do it again. Well, all right. It's in blue. So I guess sometimes you can photograph it in such a way that you will not see the blue. All right. Anyway, that's what we have here. And of course, we have to now maybe register one more piece of information. Those are free indices. These are also free indices, okay? Although they are free of a specific type, particles and holes. And now we have to contract all the lines. Okay, so what I'll do here, I'll again proceed systematically. I'll start by simply I'll start by focusing on lines R and S. So R can go to A. Certainly, the both operators are in a normal product form. We're not going to contract inside each of the vertices. Okay, so that is obvious. We're going to contract R with an A or S with a B, or the other way around. R with a B, S with an A. So you can imagine there will be two classes of diagrams. So let me start sketching them the usual way. So the first pair will look like this. We'll have two copies of it, so I have here A, I, B, J, P, Q, R, S, and another copy. Okay, so A, I, B, J, and then P, Q, R, S. And as I said, in the first case, we will contract R with an A and S with a B. Okay? So I'm doing just this. All right? Then, of course, you know, we have a second pair, which I will maybe, once again, try to use the entire set of blackboards on the right-hand side. So the other pair will have R connected with a B and S with an A. So let me try to use this. Labels P, Q, R, S, A, I, B, J, P, Q, R, S, A, I, B, J. And this, in these two, we will contract, as I already said, R with a B and S with an A. Okay? So those are the sketches, these are the initial drafts that tell us how to start our work. And then, of course, you know, the next step is to recontract the remaining lines. So we can see that there are two cases in each category. We can contract P with an I and Q with a J. That's one way to do it. Okay? Or you can contract P with a J, I guess I'll go around with it, and Q with an I. Okay? Remembering that we always have to contract lines with the same orientation. So that's what you obtain in this case. Alright? In these two cases. And we can repeat the same procedure in the bottom two diagrams. Once again, you can either connect P with an I and Q with a J, or you can contract P with a J and Q with an I. Okay? And now we've got all four cases worked out. There's nothing else, as you can see, there's nothing else that diagrammatics would allow. So now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to see what are the corresponding expressions in Weak's theorem. Okay? So again, if you could, you know, actually, if you focus on these two labels, maybe that's good enough, I think, all the time. I'll be manipulating them for the next few minutes. Okay, so what would you get algebraically for this type of contraction scheme? You would have one half from the V. You would have another one half from the C2, if you did this algebraically. Both operators bring the factor of one half. You would have to sum over P, Q, R, S from the V. You would have to sum over A, B, I, J from the C2, lots of summations this time. Then you would have to have a product of matrix elements, P, Q, V, R, S, and then A, B, C2, I, J, okay, for the V and for C2. And then you would have to write, of course, the corresponding contraction scheme. So you have, let's see, I hope I can squeeze it, phi, normal product of, we have xp dagger xr, xq dagger xs, xa dagger xi, and xb dagger xj. Okay, this is what you would have to consider. As a matter of fact, you have to do it also here, so why don't I just copy it again. So sum over pqrs, sum over abij, product of matrix elements pq, B, R, S, A, B, C, 2, I, J, and then the same set of operators inside the normal ordering. So X, P, dagger, X, R, X, Q, dagger, X, S, X, A, dagger, X, I, and X, B, dagger, X, J. Okay? And of course, what you have to do now is to perform contractions. So what we have here is R contract, XR must be contracted with XA dagger. That's what the diagram says, that's what we're going to do. And then XS must be contracted with XB dagger. Okay? And both of these cases have the same situation. R going with an A and S going with a B. Okay? And the difference between them is in the remaining operators. So XB dagger must be contracted with XI here. Okay, so that's going to be, I guess, maybe this one. And XQ dagger with XJ. So let's see. Okay, this way. All right. And then here you would have, you know, the other situation where now XP runs into, the P line runs into J. So XP dagger has to be contracted with XJ. Okay. And then XQ dagger has to be contracted with XI. So I guess I can do it maybe. Okay? That's what you would do with Weak's theorem. Alright? And now, once again, in this case, if you did it algebraically, you would have to work equally hard. You would have to work equally hard. You have a 1 half times 1 half, sum over PQRS, sum over ABIJ. You would have to do it 12 cases, so and I'll do it in parallel this time. Then you will have to consider the product of matrix elements. Elements PQ are S times ABC2IJ. Again, doing the same work in our last diagram. And then you would have to recreate the contraction. So here we have phi normal product of x p dagger x r x q dagger x s x a dagger x I x b dagger x j. Okay? And of course we'll have the same thing here. How about if I just do this? Factory style processing, copying this. And now all we need to do is to do the rest of the work, which is just contract the corresponding indices. So we have here R connected with the B, which means that XR goes into XB dagger and XS goes into S. A dagger, so here the same. And the final sets of contractions will be, in the first case, we connect P with an I. Okay, so I have P, XP dagger connect going to XI, and XQ dagger going to XJ. And this one has P connected to a J. So we have this very long contraction going to the extreme two operators, and then we have XQ dagger connected with XI. So I guess, okay, let me actually squeeze it here. Hopefully, yes. All right. Well, that's the whole picture. So, Nicole, could you see now? Could we see now the entire? Okay, great. Because, you know, that's the situation. Now, the next thing is, of course, to redraw these operators in a nice form and write the corresponding expressions. Okay, so what do we get in the case of the first diagram, the one that you see at the very top? You can see that we have A going to R and then returning on the PI collection. Okay, so that's one loop. Okay? And I don't have to use the argument that A runs into R, so I have to call it an A, because I'm going to call it an A anyway. It's a free summation line, okay, of the particle type. Okay? So actually here the situation is in a way easier. You know, we are summing all these indices anyway, and all I just have to remember that when you go from right to left, it's a particle line. So I'm going to have to call it an A anyway, okay? So when you start drawing this diagram, okay, you have two vertices, and you will have the AI loop in it, but now all these indices A, B, I, J will be free. Okay? So in particular A and I are free. And then you have a second loop, you can clearly see. B S returning on QJ. So that's gonna be B, that's gonna be J. Okay? So the second loop then does this one. Okay? What would be the expression that the algebra of Wick's theorem would give us? Okay, if I worked out this top expression, I'll just copy from here, the result is plus 1 over 4, the sum over AB, IJ, IJ, V, AB, times AB, C2, IJ. Okay, this is from Wick's theorem. Alright? And you can of course see it here, I guess it's clear, right? P will be replaced by an I, Q will be replaced by a J, R by A, and S by B. Okay? So that's what I just did. Okay? But I have to sum over A, B, I, J, because you can see we start with 8 fold summation, we end up with 4 fold summation. Algebraically, because of the deltas from contractions. Diagrammatically, we end up with 4 summations because we are connecting 3 lines. Okay, when you connect 3 and 3, you end up with a 3 line, so you have to sum over. So we have 4 lines, we have to have a quadruple summation. Okay? and the lines have a well-defined particle hole character. So that's the first diagram. If you do the same with the second diagram, you will now have a different situation. If you follow how we travel here, we go from, you know, you go on A to R, then on T to J, then you continue with B to S, and then you're returning to where you started. So there's one long loop, okay, that emerges, that has this form. You go with A, you continue here with line J, then you continue here with B, and then you return to the origin on line I, okay? That's what this second picture represents. Again, if you work out the Weak's theorem, you will end up with minus 1 over 4 sum over A, B, I, J, J, I, V, A, B times A, B, C, 2, I, J. And for the remaining two diagrams, repeating the same procedure, you can see that the third diagram has also one loop. If you start it from here, you can see A goes to S, that's an A, right? Then you return with Q into J, then you go back to the top, simple vertex of the V, and then you return to the start. So there's one long loop once again, okay? Let's draw this the resulting diagram with it. So we have I, A, J, B, this way, okay, that's what it says, you can check it easily, I, A, J, B, okay, it's just drawn in this messy way, all right? And the corresponding algebraic expression would, that you read from Weak's theorem would be minus 1 over 4, sum over A, B, I, J, I, J, B, B, A, B, C, 2, I, J. And the final one is an interesting one, because if you look at it, say, let's start here. You go on an A, go down. But then you're on a Q, you turn back. So there's a loop going across from the top part to the bottom part. And the same here. If you go with a V, you return back on the J. Okay, so you see there's another loop. So there will be two loops, but actually crossing each other. Okay, at least in the original drawing. Okay. So we'll end up with the BJ loop going this way. And then the AI loop going this way. Okay, that's how this picture will look like. Again, if I just read the all this Weak's theorem stuff, I'll end up with plus 1 over 4, sum over A, B, I, J, matrix element J, I, V, B, A, B, C, 2, I, J, which obviously you see here. You can see what happens. P becomes J, Q becomes I, so it's JI in the bra, and then R becomes B, and then S becomes A, so it's BA in the cat. Okay, so I got everything correct here. So what do we have? This situation we have already seen. Okay, we have a repetition of diagrams. Clearly, if I may, maybe I'll use again some sort of a numbering scheme. If this is diagram one, this is diagram two, then this is diagram 3, and this is diagram 4, then I can see that 1 and 4 are the same, and 2 and 3 are the same. Well, you know, this time it doesn't look as obvious as last time, maybe, so let's sort of work on it a little bit. So why is it that 1 and 4 are the same? Because what you have to do, it's topology, it's a rubber geometry, you can stretch things and so on and so forth. As long as you do not detach lines from their simple vertices, you're not allowed to detach lines in those processes. You can manipulate, you know, right, with some sort of elastic material, but you know, but you are not supposed to detach lines from their various super simple vertices. So, but what I can do here is, I can do the following. I can just flip these two simple vertices with the lines that go that are attached to them. If I do this, you can see that these loops will stop crossing. You'll end up with a picture of the top. So 1 is 4. Right here. 1 is 4. And the same happens with 2 and 3. Well, that one is a little bit easier, but again, you know, all I need to do to bring 3 to the form shown in 2 is by simply flipping these two simple vertices. Then, you know, what happens is that here we have AB crossing. If I do this flip, then AB will stop crossing. That's what you see here. But then the price will be that the IJ lines, which are not crossing in 3, will stop crossing in 2. Okay? So that's all that will happen. So we can see that 2 and 3 are the same. And as a matter of fact, of course, this is something expected. Weak's theorem would give you the same repetitions. If you look at this algebraically, the first and the last terms are equivalent. Because if I want to bring this form from Weak's theorem to the first form, to the first diagram form, then you know you just have to flip IJ and AB simultaneously, and it becomes term number 1. And the same happens here. You can see if I flip, say, IJ and AB here, simultaneously, I can always do this, then I obtain form number 2. So this is suggesting right away, okay, that we should be able to obtain the final result with just two diagrams, okay, by simply multiplying the Weak's theorem results by a factor of 2 in each case, because of these repetitions, okay? We've seen it before, we see it once again, but now we see it in a context where we have three summation lines, okay? So we expect that we only need two diagrams to represent the entire problem. A, I, B, J, remembering that these lines are free, all of them, all four of them. Okay? So we have these two diagrams. I'm going to pick up number 1, call it an A, and I'm going to pick up, say, 2. So A goes here, what I have there is J, okay, keep it B and I, okay, so that's going to be diagram B, so we have A, J, B, I, that's the way the lines go, and we will obtain the correct result if, as I said, okay, we'll simply read the Weak's theorem results and multiply them by a factor of 2 because each diagram repeats itself twice. Okay, so in other words, I should interpret this result as not 1 over 4, but 1 half, okay, not 1 over 4, and then I would have a summation over A, B, I, J, just like you have there, I, J, V, A, B, times A, B, C, 2, I, J, okay, and I should interpret the second diagram here as minus 1 half, not minus 1 over 4, summation over A, B, I, J, V, say B, A, this way, A, B, C, 2, I, J, okay? So in other words, we can make a claim that if I really form this product, V2, C2, and if I bracket it with a phi, I should obtain a sum over the resulting non-equivalent diagrams interpreted in this way, okay? Those are again non-equivalent resulting diagrams. Resulting diagrams, okay? So, are we surprised by this? Not really anymore, probably, after seeing the previous cases. All right? We can also see that our formulas are consistent with our interpretation, where KR is the sign, the weight, the sum over internal and external indices, times the scalar factor, dr chi r prime chi r double prime times the operator part is labeled by the external lines, okay? This is what we always claim. This representation of the resulting diagrams is preserved in our expressions, okay? You can clearly see it. You know, if I look at the first diagram, maybe I'll do it at the bottom, it's probably not that much space there, you can see that to achieve this consistency between our formula for KR and our actual expressions, for the diagrams A and B, then in A, you will have to interpret the sign to be plus 1, the weight to be 1 half, not 1 over 4. The internal indices there, then, you know, are A, I, B, J, okay? There are no external indices. How about if I read it this time differently? So it's an empty set, okay? We do not have any external indices in the diagram, okay? The scalar factor is a product of, should be then I, J, V, A, B, times A, B, C2, I, J, okay? And the operator part, which before I was sort of ignoring, but let's now do it, you know, nicely. It's really a unit operator, okay? So it's a normal product formula of an empty set of operators, which is a unit operator, okay? Of course, we are then bracketing this stuff with phi, so of course, you know, bracketing phi, unit operator phi gives you 1, okay? So of course, you know, and before we didn't write that, but right now I'm going to do this so that we can see the sort of the entire interpretation. And for the B, our results are also consistent. Sine is minus 1, weight is 1 half once again. We have the same set of internal lines. We have an empty set for the external lines because there are none. And then the scalar, dr, okay, is very similar. It differs only by a permutation of indices A and B in the first matrix element. So we have A, B, C2, I, J here. Okay, and then the operator part is of course the same in both cases because there are no external. Right. So you can see everything is so far so good. And then of course, you know, this is the right result too. You know, if I, you know, we know that this is the right result because I already said in the beginning what the right result is. If you add these things together, okay, if you just sum them, you end up with you end up with 1 half sum over A, B, I, J, I, J, V, A, B, anti-symmetrized. That's what these two will produce combined, and then you have A, B, C, 2, I, J. So I got the right result from these two diagrams, so that's good. The result is consistent. These results for the diagrams are consistent with our interpretation of using non-equivalent diagrams and interpreting with the sine, weights, and scalar factors. And the question is, can we understand it again? I guess we can, right? We know now that what we're really doing here, we're forming. So I'm not going to now go into these sort of details as I did before, because we know what's going to happen. When you form this product, okay, the scalars will multiply themselves, right? Just like we did before. So we, you know what, you have to multiply the scalars, I should say. And so then if you look at the at these diagrams, indeed, you know, I get the right scalar factors if I multiply the scale, the matrix elements of both vertices. You see, the first one is, you know, outgoing line I, outgoing line J, incoming A and B. That's your matrix element here. Okay? And you can see that if I read this vertex, it's A, B, I, J. A, B, C, to I, J. Okay? So I get this, you know, I obtain the correct result from a diagram. And the same thing here. To get the right to scalar factor, because we are forming a product of two operators, we have to multiply the scalar factor. So if you do this, you can again see. The first one will be, say, if I pick up, say, I, J, and the corresponding incoming line is B, A, that's the V part, and then for the C2, we still have A, B, I, J. Outgoing, outgoing, incoming, incoming, in that order, okay? And, you know, so we got, we certainly can interpret this. The sign, well, we already know the rule that we expect for the signs is minus 1 to the L plus H. Okay, if you look at our diagrams, here we have two loops and two internal whole lines. That explains why this is a plus. Here we have one loop and two internal whole lines. This is why this is a minus. And the weight, of course, still remains a little bit undefined, but we expect that we get our, you know, with our definition of the weights, we know what's going to happen. The product of the original weight Okay, if you look at our original expression here, this one here, what we're gonna, if you really look at it, it's gonna be weight of V times weight of C, and then times the number of times you obtain a given expression, Weak's theorem. So we simply expect that the weight of V, if I write it this way, of Vn, times weight of C2, okay, coming from our expression, times the number of times you have to produce a given diagram or a given contraction scheme in Weak's theorem should give you the final weight. Okay? We expect this formula. And of course, it does work in our case. If you look at, in our case, nr is 2 for each resulting diagram. Weights are 1 half. So you can see that the weight for each of the two diagrams is going to be 2 for the number of times you can obtain, either A or B, times 1 half, times 1 half. So it's going to be 1 half. And this is the weight we claim. Okay? Now, of course, you know, we're not going to be doing this kind of work to get the weight. We're going to get the weight from a skeleton. Skeleton, in each case, will be actually a diagram stripped of the indices because they're all free. So you're going to be looking at the shape, like, say, diagram A, but without having AI or BJ in it. Just the topological shape. And that shape will have two operations that do not make it, that make it a invariant. That is the identity and the replacement of loop AI by loop BJ. Okay, we'll talk about it when we get there. So, so I guess my next example, the last one, will, which we'll show here, will be an example where we do not compute an expectation value anymore. We'll actually apply the operator to the wave function. Okay, so you'll see now how, what we do with the external lines. But I guess maybe let's have a few minute break if you like, unless you don't like. But if you like, let's say 5 minutes, we'll start a little late, and then we'll do this last example. Thank you. Okay, so I guess I have a slow start. So our final example will deal with a situation where we apply an operator to a wave function, and I'll choose a situation, a simple situation like this. We have a one-body operator in the normal power form Zn acting on the singly excited determinant phi Ia, okay, which of course is the same as Zn acting on the excitation operator Eia acting on the Fermi vacuum state phi. So Zn here is the one-body operator, which could be, for example, the one-body part of the Hamiltonian in the normal product form in this example, and Eia is the familiar Xa dagger Xi operator, which of course is an operator in the normal product form, as we already said so many times. Okay, we would like to know, yeah, so see, this is a different case because we're not going to bracket this with the phi anymore. Okay, well, you know, that means that we'll have to actually look at diagrams with external lines. All right, so let's see how do we proceed in this case. So once again, you start with drawing diagrams along the time axis from left to right in this course. That is Z. Okay, then I have another operator, Eia. That's an excitation operator, which we represent with this thick filled circle here. Okay, we know that we'll have to apply this to the phi. So I'll do what I did before, apply it to the phi. Okay, we know that lines PQ are free. We are going to sum them over. Lines A and B, though, are fixed. Okay? And now we need to create all the resulting diagrams. This time, unlike in the previous cases, we have to consider all possible contraction schemes, including those where we do not, all terms in the right-hand side of Wick's theorem, I should say, including the term where we do not actually connect all any of the lines here. Okay? This is going to have to be done. Of course, we don't have to worry about connecting P with a Q because we have normal ordering. We cannot, of course, connect A with an I, okay? The delta AI would just kill this expression, okay? But it is also a normal ordering. We wouldn't do this. So we have to, if we start contracting, we have to contract between the vertices. But as I said, the very first term you're going to draw is the term where you do not connect, okay? Now that's what we're allowed to do. So let's try to look at it. So the first term with no contractions. Okay, maybe I'll emphasize this by grouping these various diagrams, the resulting diagrams. No contractions. So how do you deal with no contractions? Well, let's actually go back a little bit. You're thinking, okay, no contractions means just leave it alone. No, that's not right. Because we are acting on the phi. You remember, when you act on the phi, all the annihilation operators y have to be contracted. If you're not contracting anything, you have to have only the y dagger operators. The a and I are y dagger. They are stretching to the left, but these are not. So you have to turn those lines in this direction. Okay? They have to be extending to the left because they have to be y dagger, whole particle hole creation operators. Okay? So in other words, the resulting diagram will be something like this. This is going to be AI, and for the Z part, which you have to put in front of this one, so remember the ordering of the indices has to, of the vertices has to be preserved. You cannot put that somewhere here, okay? Well, you could because they do commute in normal ordering, but you know, that's not what you do when you start your work, okay? No need to make things complicated, okay? And that's going to be a Z now. Okay? I have to simply turn these lines and stretch them to the left. That's the requirement that is associated with acting on the phi. Well, once you do this, you have to choose the right indices. This is a particle line. You're not going to call it P anymore. you have to choose a symbol which is reserved for particle lines. Well, that's a B. We cannot use A because we're using A. So my next letter is B. Okay? This is a whole line. Okay? You can't call it Q. It was Q here before you started. Now it has to be called, has to be labeled with a symbol that represents the whole. I cannot use I because it's already used, so I have to call, I'm going to choose the next letter in the alphabet, J. Okay? To do this. That's the proper representation with the remembering that B and J are free. Here. We're summing over BJ, we don't sum over AB. Okay? That's how you process the first case. Let's look at it actually algebraically. What would you do algebraically with it? You would have sum over PQ, okay, from the Z. You would have PZQ. Then you would have a normal product of XP dagger XQ, XA dagger XI, all acting on the phi, right? That would be your work. And you said, okay, no contractions, so no contractions. All right? But we are not done yet. See, that would not be a right final formula because in the normal ordering, you have to have only Y dagger operators. Okay? How do I force? So these are Y dagger. This is Y dagger, this is Y dagger. No worries here. They are the Y dagger operators. We know that already. But these are not necessary. Depends on P and Q. So how do I convert XP dagger into Y dagger? I have to force P to be unoccupied. Then XP dagger becomes YP dagger. What about this? If I want to make this Y dagger, so it doesn't annihilate the vacuum, okay, then I have to make sure that Q is occupied. You see, so there is, even in this diagram where you do nothing almost, you still have to watch out for the symbols. Okay? You see, I will have to rewrite this as a summation, not over PQ, but if I want to have P unoccupied, I guess I'll call it a B. And if I want to have Q occupied, I'm going to call it a J. And then you have to simply replace PQ bar BJ consistently everywhere. So you have B, Z, J. And then you have a normal product of XB dagger, XJ, XA dagger, XI, acting on the phi. Okay, so XB dagger, XJ, XA dagger, XI, acting on the phi. Okay? Okay, let's stop right here. That's fine. Well, let's look at then cases where we have some contractions. We don't have many lines, so then we'll have cases with one contraction. Okay? What are those? You can contract B, Q with an A or P with a J. Sorry, P with an I. Okay? So let's start with Q contracted to Q contracted with an A. Okay. So let's see how we're gonna do this. So let's first start with the original sort of picture. P Q, and then you have let's do it this way. AI, and I'm saying I'm going to contract now Q with an A. Okay? Just one contraction, nothing else. So what's the resulting diagram for it? After redrawing. Okay, it's going to be again two vertices. Let's start with the right vertex for the excitation operator. And now let's watch what happens in it. See, if you look at I, it's just I, the I line going into it. So I'm going to just draw it by simply having that line maybe down here. I can always do this. As I said, it's topology, right? Once I arrive at the right vertex, I have to connect A with a Q. But A is fixed. Q is free. Fixed and free is fixed. So then I'm going to the Z vertex with an A line. And then the question is, what do I do with this line P, which is sort of hanging around? Okay? And sort of like a landing point, right? Well, what do I do with this? I kind of leave it sort of pointing in an arbitrary direction because I'm acting on the phi, which means that the line has to be stretched, has to extend to the left. When it extends to the left, you have to call it accordingly. It's a particle line. So I have to use the symbol B for it. which is gonna be summed over, because there is, you know, remember there was a rule. External lines retain their character. If they are fixed, they are fixed. If they are free, they are free. You can't do anything about them because you're not doing anything to them. So that's gonna be also free. That's the diagonal. What would you do algebraically for it? Well, again, I guess, it's really probably the last time I do such things, but let's do it one last time. So what we have here is a normal ordering of x p dagger, x q, x a dagger, x I, acting on the phi, and I'm being told that I have to contract a with q, okay? In other words, you have to do this. X q has to be contracted with x a dagger. Okay? Well, let's read it. What would the algebra tell you? Well, first of all, this contraction, so actually I'm going to keep writing, so it's a summation over pq, pzq, then you have a contraction which gives you the pi q, the step function pi q, and then delta qa, and then we have a normal product of xa dagger xi, acting on the phi, okay? Well, the delta will replace q by a. But then, and we can eliminate the step function. But we're not done, because, I did something wrong here, xp. Xp dagger, okay, xp dagger xi. So the delta will eliminate the q, okay? So we know that there won't be any summation over q. But what about the p? I cannot leave it with this form. This must be a par particle symbol, because this must be a y dagger operator. This one is a y dagger operator, but this is not necessary. If p is occupied here, that's a y line. Y acting on the phi gives you zero. So you have to force p to be constrained to unoccupied states. But if it's unoccupied, then it's a, you cannot call it p anymore. You have to call it, say, b. Okay? So I'm going to really finish with saying that p will be called b. So you will have B instead of P, okay? Maybe I'll mark it here. That's what we're doing. Then we already said that Q is fixed at A through the delta, and then you have a normal product of XB dagger XI acting on the phi. That is the proper read of this diagram, okay? So let's do two more. So the next possibility, as you can easily imagine, is to simply contract, P with an I, okay? So let's do it as our third case. So what we start with PQ and our excitation vertex, AI, and we are supposed now to contract P with an I. So the diagram that will represent it will be as follows. You can see that what we have here, we have this line A, which is simply left intact. So I'm going to have this line. But then when it comes to the line with the Z, you can see we have line Q incoming. I'll comment on this in a moment. So there will be incoming line. And then the P connects to I. P is free, I is fixed, so that's going to be an I. The question is again, what do we do with the Q? We cannot leave it, sort of, you know, sitting there unchanged. We have to fix it such that we have to make it a line extending to the left. But when it extends to the left, and it's an incoming line here, it must be a whole line. When it's a whole, I have to call it accordingly. Not an I, it's a fixed, so it has to be a J. The free line. Okay, that's how the diagram looks like. And again, if you repeat the algebraic work on it, it's going to be a sum over PQ, PZQ, okay, and then a normal ordering of XP dagger, XQ, X A dagger, XI, okay, acting on the phi. In this case, we contracted P with an I, so this is what we did. Okay, so if you continue algebraically, just rewriting the whole thing, then you can see we have this contraction will produce a chi, p step function chi p delta p I, okay? And then we're left with a normal product of these two. But I can flip those two. So I end up with a normal, with a negative of a normal product of x a dagger x cube acting on the phi. Okay? That's what you do. Now, the delta will fix the p, so this will become I. But we're not done yet. And then of course chi can go away. Because cube cannot be unoccupied. Because if it's unoccupied, that becomes a y dagger. When it's, sorry, it has to be.
What did I do?
Okay, so Q has to be, you know, Q has to be J, right? It has to be an occupied line to produce y dagger here. Okay? So again, so remember, we have to replace Q by J because of the fact that we're acting on the phi. So this is also J. So the final rewrite of this is a summation, not over Q, but over J. No, the summation over P is gone. Then we end up with I, Z, J, and then a normal product of X, A dagger, X, J, acting on the phi. We're summing over J here. And the final expression, almost there now, okay, is the fully contracted term. You can also do this. You know, fully contracted, of course, is a must for you when you do expectation values. But here we also have to do it. We have to go all the way. All the terms are weak zero. Okay? So the fully contracted, of course, is the easiest one for us to do because we already did so many examples in this category. But there is one caveat here which I will have to emphasize. Surely, fully contracted means contract all the lines. Q with an A, P with an I, okay? And you know, not surprising to us, the diagram that comes out is this, AI, you know, A is fixed, Q is free, so it's an I, sorry, so it's an A, and then P is free, I is fixed, so it's an I line, so that's the diagram, okay? But it's not a scalar. It's actually scalar times phi. So remember, so here I will make a little note that what you have to do with this, when you read this diagram, you have to multiply it by the phi. Because remember, your expression was ZNE acting on the phi. Okay? In other words, you cannot just read it as a number. It's not a number that you add to your expression. It's a number that you got from this diagram times phi. So sometimes a diagram means the new number. Sometimes it means the number times the function, if that's what you were doing in the beginning. So you always have to remember where you came from. Okay, so a little warning here. Anyway, when I do this diagrammatically, of course, that's an easy one. This I'll do it very quickly. Normal product of xp dagger, xq, xa dagger, xi, acting on the phi, but this time fully contracted, q with an a, p with an I. So of course, we end up with no summations. You're going to end up with P becoming I and Q becoming A. I hope it's clear to you. But see, that's not. If I finish here, that's wrong. There's phi. So you have to multiply by phi. It's a number times the phi. Okay? So now, as you can see, we've got now all of our stuff worked out. Maybe I'll move this up so you can see now all four blackboards for a moment. That's what we obtained. Four diagrams represent our expression. Okay? Let's do two things to sort of at the end of this lecture. Let's check the consistency with our expectations. We expect that when we apply Zn to EIA and act on the phi, we should end up with a summation of the resulting diagrams, okay, admissible by the problem, in this case essentially all diagrams, because you know there was no way to remove something in the process. But In those diagrams, all the lines have to extend to the left. Okay, there is one thing that the fact that you act on the phi brings to our considerations. Our interpretation of the KRs, the sign, the weight, the summation over internal and external indices, the scalars, labeled by possibly both, and the operator part labeled by only external, is preserved. If I go through all these diagrams, you can see that the first one, now I'll do it quickly just by copying. Okay, so this is A, I, B, J. Remembering that B, J are free. So the first diagram has this form. Okay, the value of it is written here. And as you can see, so the value of it is a summation over B, J, what is it? B, Z, J, times, actually I write it, if you really look at what careful about it is, it's a double excitation, double excited determinant. Okay, so it is really I, J, A, B. That's the read of this expression. And you can see I get this expression, you know, using this topological understanding. As long as I agree that sine is 1, weight is 1, sine is plus, I should say, or plus 1, okay. The internal indice, the internal lines, it's an empty set, so you can see I, you know, this works. There are no external lines, so you see an empty set. The external lines, we only have external lines here. It's a set of line of indices A, I, and B, J. The scalar, very simple here. It's simply matrix element B, Z, J. And the operator part, that's the new element. We didn't see this before. Before I was saying, let's ignore the operators. Well, no, we ignore them here. The operator part, you can see, if you read it this way. Outgoing line, outgoing, incoming. So for each, this actually is an example of what we call, describe as an open path. Open path in a Goldstone diagram is a sequence of Fermion lines where you start with one, go through a diagram, and leave with one, okay? That's what we're doing. It's a very simple open path, as simple as possible. You come in and you leave. So it's xa dagger xi. So the operator part is xa dagger xi for the first path. There's a second open path here, j becoming b. So that's xb dagger xj. Okay? And it's all in normal product because those are resulting diagrams. When they are resulting, they are normal order. So you always put an n, even when, you know, you don't have to think much, but you just put it there. That's, you have to do this, right? And we know that this agrees with this expression. And it gives a very read because when you apply this operator to the field, you obtain this part. Okay? So this is our first expression. You can see we are consistent. Well, that's great. Let's look at the next, the remaining diagrams. Okay? How about, let's see, oh yeah, it's still there. Okay, so I'm going to slowly erase. So I'm going to still keep this one. Okay, so I'm going to switch. Okay. I see the whole thing. Yeah. Okay, so now we're going to do this diagram, okay? I will perhaps, okay, this one has to go. So I will redraw this diagram, the diagram with one contraction here. What we have in it is the same picture. You can sort of write it below in your notes. I'll do it again and then erase. So what we have is B, A, and I, okay? The result is a sum over B, B, Z, A, and you can see here we have a singly excited slated determinant, phi I, B, that's the final expression for it. And again, this is consistent with our way of reading diagrams, okay? Because, with our way, because I can say that sine is plus 1, weight is 1, the internal indices, well, they do exist now. There is one. So it's not an empty set anymore. It's actually that line A belongs here. For the external indices, we have two of them, I and B, or B and I. Okay? So you see now I'm filling really every element of our formula. That formula is rich enough to allow you to do this. Then the scalar factor, labeled by internal and external lines, actually working, that's what we have here, is BZA, okay, BZA, and the operator part, labeled by external lines, corresponds to the open path. Remember that now, because that's, we're going to prove this eventually. This is an open path again. Sequence of Fermion lines. Okay, you go with I, A, B. So how do you read that operator? The line that leaves the path, and the line that comes into the path. So it's xb dagger xj in the normal ordering, always. Okay, and then it's of course in agreement will be, I guess I. xb dagger xi, consistent with our expression, okay? So that looks fine, we can read it this way. Okay, so we are down to two more. So let's, do it here. The third diagram that we got was a ji, right? So j being free, the expression for it is a sum over I z j with a negative, and then phi j a, okay, and I sum over j. All right, that's the expression for it that we obtained, and you can see again it is consistent with our form of kr. Sine now is minus one, dub weight is one. The internal lines, we have only one in this set. External lines, there are two of them, A and J. The matrix, the scalar, dr, okay, labeled by all these lines, is izj, and the operator part is again read from the path. Okay, you have xa dagger xj, those are the lines that define the path in the normal product. Okay, and the final one, okay, let's see, there, the final one is, so now we are really, really done. This one that I'm now erasing, but now it's probably fine. So once again, what we have is this picture, and the result is I, Z, A times phi, okay, again, if you look at this from the topological point of view, sine should be plus one, weight is one, scalar factor is IZA. We have only internal lines. So those are the lines AI. We do not have external lines, so that's an empty set. Okay, you can see that our formula for KR accommodates all these different situations. It's general enough. Okay, and then the scalar itself, labeled by all the lines, in this case only internal, but let's keep it this way, it's IZA. And the operator part, well, it's there. It is just the normal product of an empty set, because there are no open paths. No open paths means empty set. But what is the normal product of an empty set? It's a unit operator, so you have to multiply phi by a unit operator. That's all you have to do. You see, it works fine. So maybe let me finish by simply saying, okay, so if I go through this list now, first of all, if you want to present the result to someone, okay, you just have to add those four numbers. Please note, so you simply, if you want to say, what is Zn acting on phi ia, you simply have to say, this plus this plus this and plus this one. You can see it's a CI expansion. You multiply Z by the singling sign determinant, and you obtain as the leading term the term that has doubles. Then you have the term, two terms which have singles, and you have one term which has, which is a reference contribution. A beautiful CI expansion. Okay, came out of it. Second, all of this is consistent with our general diagrammatics and topological forms. And then, do we understand this these various elements? So why the sign here is plus one? Because there are no internal lines, and there are no loops. Well, L is zero, H is zero, that's a plus. Okay, white weight is one, okay. Here we know so far at least one thing. There was no repetition of diagrams, so the weight is the product of weights. Each weight is one, so one times one is one. So, you know, no repetition, no need to worry about anything, okay? But of course we'll learn why the weights are one, why the weights are one in each case later. Okay? Matrix element, look, I can read it. Nothing to read from here because it's one. I just have to read this one. B, Z, J. Isn't it? B, Z, J. Okay? And the operator part, as I said, you just read it from the open paths. You go to the next line and the same thing happens. Again, right? It's a free line here. You can see that, once again, matrix element is BZA times 1, so that's BZA. The open path gives you this determinant, okay? And sine is 1, why? Because there is not no loops, so L is 0. But we have, and we have no internal whole lines, you know, you don't count internal lines, you count internal whole lines. There is no whole line here, right? A is particle. So that's why the sign is plus. Okay? And I guess we covered this one. And then if you go here, the same thing here. Same, you know, except for the sign. Matrix elements, again, you form a product of matrix elements. I see J times 1. Well, that's your matrix element. Okay? Not here. We talked about open path producing the determinant or the excitation operator here. Okay? Weight is 1. Okay? We talked about it already. The sign is minus 1. Why? Because there are no loops, but there is one internal whole line. Minus 1 to the L plus H is minus here. Okay? And the final expression, once again, sign is plus because there's one loop and one internal whole line, so you get a plus. Okay? A matrix element, you just read it from a diagram. Product of matrix elements. I, Z, A. Times 1. Well, that's I, Z, A. Okay? And the operator part is the unit operator because there are no open paths. You see? This whole thing works like magic. Yeah? We can get any expression right. Of course, you know, those were simple because I wanted to do the, you know, parallel Weak's theorem work. From now on, I'll rarely be doing this, maybe never. Okay, it's because we don't have to. We'll be just drawing diagrams and learning from them directly. Okay, that's our plan. So next time we'll introduce the important concepts of skeletons and weights that allow us to produce these numerical factors precisely without counting how many times a given diagram appears. You don't want to do this. You just want to get straight to the resulting diagram and read it. Okay, that's what we're gonna be doing next time. So thank you very much. I'll see you.